Ladies and gentlemen, I am delighted to begin the session on education in Pakistan with a focus on textbooks. I would like to introduce our panelists, Dr. Tariq Rahman is a highly published scholar and has written 90 articles, 10 books, and several encyclopedia articles. He is the author of Language, Ideology, and Power, Denizens of an Alien World, and Language and Politics in Pakistan, and his recent book From Hindi to Urdu. Dr. Pervez Hoodbhoy is a nuclear physicist. And he teaches at LUMS in Lahore and at Qaid-e-Azam University in Islamabad. Baela Raza Jamil. Baela is a public policy specialist and former technical advisor to the Ministry of Education. Mr. Faisal Bari has been teaching and researching in the areas of economic development and social economic issues in developing countries. For the last 14 years, he has worked on education, social protection, growth and development. I would like our panelists to speak for about 10 minutes each on the subject of education with a focus on textbooks, and after that we will throw it open to the floor for questions. So I would like to start in that order, I think, with Dr. Faisal Bari, please.
Today what I'll do is just make one argument which I have been sort of starting work on in this area for some time. And this is the issue of looking at the notion of citizenship education and what does it mean in our curriculum and how have we dealt with it and how are we dealing it in the context of not only Pakistan, but this is larger work which goes across a few countries as well. But here specifically I'll talk about Pakistan and very early sort of thoughts on a big issue that needs resolution at some point, and at least a debate which needs to get started again. Now, I go back to, so there's a book by Mufti Taqi Usmani on education, which starts off by saying that Pakistan, so Nazriyai Pakistan Yani Islam, and then he goes on to make a case for how education in Pakistan needs to be changed to make it much more consonant with the notion of Islamic education. Usme wo very clearly kehte hain, he says very clearly that what he is not looking for or arguing for is the addition of Islamiyat as a subject which might be taught once a day or once a week, and he's essentially looking at a redoing of the education system in a way that everything becomes, from an Islamic point of view, it becomes somehow synthesized with the Islamic point of view. And the argument that he gives is that if you're going to teach economics, then that economics has to be not the Western models as developed outside, but maybe Western models developed outside but intermediated through a lens of Islam and so on. Same thing for Nafsiyat, Imraniyat, whatever the subject. And he says only then can we call this system of education Islamic and or consonant with Islam, and hence will be able to address the needs of Pakistan. Now this is, I mean, this issue goes back obviously a long time. If you go back to, this is a point of departure for me. I just used Maulana Usmani as just to give one side of the argument. Whereas the notion of citizenship education has other sides, of course, from the secular, from the nationalist, and so on and so forth. But it's a debate and a question that has not been addressed in Pakistan. Even though we have swept it under the carpet many times, it's something that remains unresolved, and hence that contradiction and that lack of consensus shows up again and again, not only in our books, but in the curriculum and in the teaching of it as well. I go back to Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan's article, one article in particular he wrote about education, in which he had, obviously Sir Sayyid's response to the education challenge was very different from Deoband and Brailvi and so on, even from Nadwa. His response was that yes, Muslims have to learn the modern education and what it offers, not only the languages but also the sciences and so on and so forth. But he had a deeper argument as well, which he was making. He said in one of his articles that what he is concerned about, so he thought that the Deoband response was very defensive, mudafiana response, a very defensive response. And he said that he could understand why that is, because one thing he said was that if you want to really make the education system Islamic, then any time you offer both Islamic and modern education at the same time, the Islamic education system and thought, etc., will get trumped. And it will get trumped because his point was that we don't have the kind of scholars, the kind of Islamic scholars steeped in Islam that could somehow carry on a dialogue with the Western education and create that synthesis that was needed. So for him, he said, I'm paraphrasing, I can understand why this defensive response from Deoband, because there's a realization that it is hard to confront and develop that consensus on education from an Islamic point of view, given that the state of Muslim scholarship at that time, that of in the post 1857 era, 70s, 80s, was at a stage where we could not really have a productive dialogue and synthesis. And so Sir Sayyid went on to say that this is a problem which we'll have to confront by actually going through modern education, building it up, our own capacities and so on. And that's a question that still remains today. He gave the example that when Islamic thought were confronted Greek thought, there were a level of scholars which were able to take from Greek thought what they thought was useful, also go into a dialogue with Greek thought and create some form of a census, consensus, whatever your synthesis, that created a lot of potential for Islamic education in the era that we know of Islamic sort of effervescence of the arts and sciences and literature and so on. That question confronts us even today. Even today, there is a complete lack of consensus on this issue of how our textbooks are to be shaped. On one side is the very strong position, which is not only in madrasas, but it is in our regular books also, of how to treat Islamic studies and Islam, and how to bring that into other subjects, if at all. And of course, the camp that says that there is no need to do that, and hence we don't address it at all. But the result of that is that even every policy that you see from on education has some references to Islami tashakhus, Islamic identity, Muslim identity, and so on. And the translation of that into textbook happens in a very haphazard way, where we create all the kinds of problems that we know. These are that other people have written about, whether it be Rupina Sehgal or Tariq Saab or Pervez Saab, etc. They have written about what happens when there is a clear lack of consensus and so on. And in fact, the point of departure also becomes very strong, where in 1880s or 90s, there were people who could talk across these divides. We are now a much more fragmented society, where the scholars across these divides are much less available and much less possibly in the mainstream dialogue. We read sub-dialogues and consider them to be mainstream in Pakistan, but we don't have an overall dialogue that looks at these issues in education and so on from the curriculum point of view. So in a much more fragmented society, this issue which goes throughout our policy and even continues today, and if I may give the example, in the early 1948, 49, 50, 55, up to 60, you go, get references in education policy papers about how to bring madrasa and mainstream together, what to do, how do you introduce secular subjects into madrasa, or do you introduce some midway, or do you introduce Islamic subjects in regular school? How do you bring them closer and make one particular stream, which under the colonial stream one could understand many streams, but once Pakistan is built, why isn't there a unitary education system that we can think about? So there are early references, but they go away at some point. And in the 60s, there was an attempt to introduce some secular subjects in madrasas. This happened more in East Pakistan. About 5,000 odd madrasas did get those introductions, but that didn't really happen in West Pakistan. And so this dialogue in West Pakistan hasn't really gone on. It still remains a Canadian writer who wrote a book called Between the Quebecois and the English Canadians. He wrote a book called The Two Solitudes. So I'll end my remarks here by saying that we are again at a point where not maybe there are more than two solitudes, but solitudes they are. These are people who are arguing in silos yet again, and this will mean that the education and our curriculum will continue to suffer because we cannot come to a consensus of how to look at this issue of citizenship when we are, most of us might be Muslim, but we are living in multicultural, multi-ethnic societies. I'll come back to the issues at the question time or something later.
One of the purposes of the textbooks everywhere is to construct a national identity. Now, this is an official narrative which is based on, in our case especially, but otherwise elsewhere too, on exclusion, erasure, marginalization. For instance, exclusion is that anything common between Pakistan and North India, including the language, is erased. I mean, it's simply excluded. Prehistory, that is to say, before the 8th century, before Muhammad bin Qasim arrived, is excluded. So, many people have written on this. K.K. Aziz has written about the murder of history of Pakistan. Dr. Pervez Hoodbhoy and Dr. Nair wrote a book first a long time back about these things. What is wrong with our textbooks, etc.? Rubina Segal has written about it. Subtle Subversion is a very 2004 product, I believe. It's a report which is on this. So it's not a new issue. Many people know about it. Why doesn't it go away? In my view, it doesn't go away because the way the state has been constructed is by exclusion, is by othering. The India is the other. And therefore, all construction of the state has to be focused upon this India-centeredness, one. And the other reason is that Islam being this Islamic nationalism, our nationalism being focused on the use of Islam as a primary symbol with Urdu as a secondary symbol, it was necessary, therefore, for the state. The logic of the state was such that they emphasized upon it to the exclusion of all other multiple narratives in this multilingual country. That is why the sidelining began early. It actually began in the 1950s. But it became more, it became stronger. Gandhi was there, he was removed because of, as power decreased and the perception of weakness increased, emphasis upon a very, on the military, upon glorification of the armed forces, wars, those kind of things increased, especially after the 1965 war. And then after the 1971 war, it increased very much. So Ziaul Haq did not introduce it, but he, of course, accelerated it, the trend. Now, I looked at textbooks. I'll just give you a small example of textbooks in my book, again published by the Oxford University Press, called Language, Ideology and Power. Since that's a huge tome, I am not going to force you to read it. Nobody reads it anyway. But that book looked at class 1 to class 10 textbooks. I was not doing the same thing which other people were doing. I was looking specifically at language textbooks. And one of the things which emerged from this, all languages, that is, optional languages, Arabic, Persian, Pashto, Sindhi, and so on and so forth, English, of course, and Urdu. What emerged from this was that there was an ideology. This ideology was the ideology of the garrison state, a state in which the military had the primary position, and in which public sentiment had to be focused in favor of the military, in which, therefore, wars, etc., had to be glorified. Their reasons were not to be given. They were to be taken for granted as necessary and, therefore, the duty of citizens. And in which the Hindu had to be vilified, because that too was part of this construction, this narrative. In which all sacrifices had to be made necessary for the public in the name of national interest, in the name of security. So Urdu was the language in which was the ideology carrying language. Not that the number of lessons of this kind, ideological lessons, were more Urdu textbooks. They were not. They were most in Arabic textbooks and in Persian textbooks. And they were also there even in Pashto textbooks and Punjabi textbooks, so as to fight any urge for the sub-national group, ethnic group, to sort of assert itself. But Urdu, I call it the ideology-carrying language because it is taught everywhere. It is compulsory. It's not an optional language. So if you have 40% lessons, and the it was 40%, 40% of the lessons are ideology carrying, you are imprinting on the minds of young people much, much more than other kind of textbooks in Persian or so on, which are optional, and so people do not read them. Now, specific instances of this was that in the 1965 war, what was given in the textbook was that suddenly on the 6th of September, India came and attacked Pakistan. That is it. Children were not explained that there was, in fact, a history, and that one kind of strategy was to send people across the border and in the vain hope of wresting Kashmir out of India. This was not given. It's a policy which was followed later with disastrous consequences, led to Kargil and so on, and you know very well the covert war which went on, but this was never questioned because it was simply never brought to the view of ordinary people and students and others, neither on the TV, nor in the films, nor in the radio, nor in the textbooks. Textbooks is not the only influence on people's mind, but it is a major influence. It is one influence among many, but it wasn't questioned anywhere. Although the number of narratives, personal stories, autobiographies, memoirs, talking about it, Air Marshal Asar Khan, General Musa, my version, and so on, there are so many of them giving this narrative, saying exactly what happened, etc. None of them are known to our students. Now, there's something else about Urdu too, not just the number of lessons. It is Urdu itself, the language itself, has been used as a symbol for Muslim nationalism. And therefore, lots of myths go into the making of this. The construction of the identity of Urdu itself is to be questioned. I have a book, and I don't know if I should be doing this, but I want to show it to you so that you can buy it, very brazenly, so that you can buy it. But then, you see, this book, published by the Oxford University Press, it's a social and political history of Urdu. It's the politics part of it is that Urdu, the myths about Urdu, such as Urdu is a martial language, is repeated again and again by the many agencies in Pakistan. I do not mean intelligence agencies. I mean all other kind of government agencies. Again and again there are papers, and again and people write about it. Children are told about it. Children call it Askari Zaban, etc. The fact, however, is that Urdu is not, Urdu has the beginnings of other normal languages. It is not created in a Lashkar. It is not a Lashkari Zaban. The word Urdu in Turkish does mean Lashkar, does mean camp, does mean military camp. But the word was there. However, the language was called Hindi for about 500 years. That is why the title of the book is From Hindi to Urdu. There's one thing called Sanskritizing. Of course, that was created in the 19th century. But there is another common language, the mother of Urdu and modern Hindi, that was called Hindi for over 500 years. Every Persian document, every Devanagari document, every other document calls it Hindi. Shaykh Bazovane Hindi Farmudand. That kind of thing you find in Persian documents. That is hidden from our children. They don't know it. They don't. So why this language started being called Urdu was because it's a contraction of the whole term Zubane Urdu hai Mualla, language of the exalted city. And the exalted city was the city of the king. And in India, the word Urdu was not used for military camp. This is Shamsur Rahman Farooqi saying this. It was always used for the king's city, that is to say, the exalted city, which was Agra and later Delhi, Shah Jahanabad. So that is a myth. Now it's a dangerous myth, because in India it embarrasses Muslims. It draws them apart as people who draw their citizenship not from ordinary rights of citizenship, but were conquerors, although they were not. Another myth is that Muslims are Arabs. Muslims are not Arabs. Muslims are mostly converted people. Some of them, of course, are Arabs. Some of them are Turks. Some of them might be Persian. Some of them are Pashto-speaking people, and so on and so forth. But they were people who accepted another faith. They were Indians first. This is another part which is erased in all our textbooks. I haven't seen anyone mentioning this. The other one, Urdu is a Muslim language. Well, Urdu by its nature is not a Muslim language. It did become a language of Indian Muslims, but there's a construction. It happened. It happens to languages. Latin now is called the language of the Vatican. It wasn't always the language of the Vatican. It was the language of people who oppressed Christians and burned Christians at one time. These things change. And then Urdu is the national language and therefore a carrier of Pakistani nationalism. Well, that is because we have made it such. Otherwise, Punjabi is spoken by 44% Pakistanis. That could also be a national language. One can have more than one national language. One can question the idea of having only one national language. Those are not done in our textbooks. So our textbooks are therefore another way of keeping the garrison state alive. And that is why I question them. And I believe this is something, unless the textbooks change, we cannot ask for people with more oriented towards peace in Pakistan. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tariq Rahman. Baela Jamil, may I ask you to... okay, Dr. Pervez Hoodbhoy. Thank you.
Let me put before you what really worries me. There's a younger generation of Pakistanis, students, who are seriously science phobic. They don't want to become scientists, they don't know what science is, and they're not interested. Now this is bad for the future of the country, because everything in our modern times depends upon people being educated in science. And if you look at India, it's a totally different story. There, the overwhelming majority of Indian students want to become scientists. And many of them go on to become some of the world's top researchers. And this is why India is where it is. That is to say, aiming towards becoming a superpower, a major economic player in the world, whereas on the other side of the border, we are being questioned as to whether we are a failing state or a failed state. I will not claim that this science phobia that we see is entirely due to textbooks, because as Tariq just said, there's a lot more to education than just textbooks. It's part of a national culture. And certainly we do not have a national culture that values science. We do not have science programs on television. We have a lot of political entertainment, to be sure, but not very much on science at all. We cannot differentiate, for the most part, between the path-breaking work done by Abdus Salam, and the copycat reverse engineering done by the bomb makers. And frankly, science is not considered attractive either by students or their parents. So one should not be surprised, therefore, that most textbooks written in Pakistan by Pakistani authors are just not worth reading, and that they have seriously impacted upon students' understanding of the subject. I've been looking at a number of them, and let me tell you what I found on descriptions of surface tension. Some of you know what it is, doesn't matter if you don't. The books written in Pakistan say that this is a skin which is formed by the attraction of molecules to each other in a liquid. Now, look, I've never seen a molecule in my life. I doubt that you could have. And why should molecules attract each other, and why should they be in liquids only? I'm confused as hell about this. On the other hand, if you look at a decent science book written anywhere outside, a decent one, it'll tell you, it'll tell the student, take a razor blade, place it slowly on the surface of water, and note that it floats. Then it'll say, add a little bit of soap to it, and the razor blade will sink. The student does that and actually arrives at an understanding of what science is. So clearly, some science books are better than others, and then the question comes about, why don't we simply take the good books that are written outside and use them in our schools, perhaps with adaptation, perhaps with translation? And that should certainly make a big difference. Of course, it won't end all problems, but it should certainly make a very big difference. Now, at that point, nationalist bravado kicks in. They say that we Pakistanis are equally capable of writing very good books. Why should we rely on the Gora? Why should we rely on the Chinese? Why should we rely on anyone else? We have the best people here. But sorry, this is just empty chest beating. It's a case of large egos and low accomplishments. You see, this argument is not made when it comes to using medicines, drugs made outside. This argument is not made when flying in airplanes or riding in cars that were made by Goras. It only kicks in when it comes to educating our children. So, here is something that is telling us not just about science education, it's telling us something much deeper, something much wider, something that Faisal Bari just talked about. The clash between modern education and traditional education. This failure of science education is actually systemic. It runs through the system. It's at the base of this is a rapidly growing reaction against modernity and modern education. Now, let's not confuse modernity with consumption. You don't become modern by drinking Coca-Cola. And you don't become modern by riding in a big car or traveling in a jet plane. You become modern when there is a mindset that looks at the world in a different way, in which reason and rationality are part of how you look at things. And so modern education is very different from traditional education. Traditional education came from up there. You could not challenge it. You had to memorize it. You could not ask your teacher, why is this? If you did, you could properly be slapped on the head that this is the way it is. And so it was a corpus of facts, fixed, permanent, to be transmitted between generation to the next generation. Whereas modern education changes all the time. We create concepts of science. What we teach to our children today will be less relevant 10 years later, even less relevant another 10, just as it has been in the past. So modern education evolves, traditional education is fixed. This means that our attempt to create that synthesis is bound to fail. It failed at the time of Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, when he was in debate with the ulema at Deoband, as Faisal was reminding us. There was a clash, a serious clash. That clash is irresolvable. Try and fix it as much as you can. You can't do it. You have to choose between fixed, unchanging beliefs that things are the way they are and will remain the way they will, between a way of life which says we don't know what the end is, we only know that we can use reason and logic and observation and experiment and go whichever way that takes us. Well, that's all well and good, but how do you go about it? I don't have the answer, but I do know that it has to begin at the school level and it cannot be done at the university level, because trying and trying for the last 35 years, I know there are very definite limits to what you can do on that. Our task is getting a bit harder with time. It's because now we are seeing a guilt conscience assert itself. We're beginning to hear more and more often that this modern Western education is an imposition on us. It's there to make us brown sahabs. Forget it. If we don't have this education, we are going back to the dark ages. Don't be apologetic about it. What we have to do is to take that modern education, use our reason and our faculties of discernment, and get out of it what we need for our day and age, for our society. Among those things, as I said, we need good textbooks. That's just one part of it, but it is a very important part of that. And let me end by saying that instead of asking for everything in the world today, at least as regards our education, what we need to do is define a set of very definite goals. These are not enough by themselves, but these are absolutely crucial if we are ever to become a modern nation. First and foremost, education has to begin with the premise that we need a spirit of openness. If the minds are closed, if you don't want to open minds, well, forget it. Then go to a madrasa and you'll get the kind of society that a madrasa produces. Go back to Nizamul Mulk of the 11th century, and if you want to know why Muslim societies across the world are stuck in a rut and have not produced one shred of science, one shred of knowledge for the last 800 years, go look at the madrasas. They will tell you. It's not lack of resources. There's plenty of oil. There's plenty of everything. It's that mindset produced by traditional education that lies at the very heart of Muslim backwardness today. So we need that openness. We have to stop viewing peoples of other countries as our friends, as people who we can live with, rather than as permanent enemies. We have to stop telling lies about history. What Tariq Rahman was telling us about Bangladesh, East Pakistan, is absolutely true. We lie and lie, and we create that paranoia, that xenophobia, which then drives us So that today there are 300 people here, I don't know how many, and there are 300,000 at the Qaid-e-Azam Mazar for the Defy Pakistan rally. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Dr. Pervez Hoodbhoy. May I now invite Baela Raza Jamil to speak to you.
I'd like to just, you know, share with you very quickly that recently a survey was conducted by the name of Annual Status of Education Report Pakistan 2011 over about 147,000 children, and the test was only for grade 2 level, English, Urdu, Sindhi and arithmetic, and we had only 47% children who could read the Urdu text, grade 2. This is 5 to 16 years old children. It was a household-based survey across 85 districts of the country. And 26% could read the English level 2 text, and only 24% could do the three-digit division. Now, when we have that kind of a concrete evidence in front of us, it just makes the things slightly more complex when it comes to Project Citizenship or addressing the issue of the constructs of identity and ideology of the past 66 years. And how do we go about addressing this conundrum? And I think it is very important for us in trying to become equipped with that capability to address this issue, we need to address the whole crisis of the curriculum as it perpetuates irrelevance and passive learning. And we know, all of us sitting here in this crowd at the Karachi Literature Festival 2012, that as, I mean, we are all and our children are preparing for a world that we cannot imagine. Changes are so rapid that obsolescence is really the order of the minute. Now, in that is the challenge of how do we address issues of textbooks and curriculum. And I think we do need to, as I think Faisal did a great job of taking us back to where the bog is created, and that is sort of going back way into the 19th century, but I would suggest even way back into the 18th and 17th century, where the disconnects begin to happen. But look at the more recent disconnects. We have from 2000 to 2009, almost an incremental, and even currently, an incremental addressing of curriculum reforms in Pakistan. So from 2000 to 2006 and 2007, we have a little bit of a curriculum change here and there, and new textbooks keep coming. And this is, by the way, in response to the SDPI and the books that we were referring to in terms of the challenges that were brought by the Pakistani citizens to this subtle conversion through the curriculum. But the government could not address this wholeheartedly. But in 2006 and 2007, the national curriculum came about. Now, the national curriculum was a change, and they did, whole teams sat together, I think many from this room also, who were involved seriously in the redesign of the national curriculum, 2006 and 7. So, from Kachi or preschool to grade 12, every subject went through a major change. Now, why that is important to us is because a book like this one, you know, these books that did come out, they are still on the website, they started giving us new terminologies such as standards-based curriculum, learning outcomes-based curriculum, and we did have definitions of new learning outcomes, and actually these curriculum frameworks are not that bad, not that bad. But here is the rub, that in spite of this, and in spite of the National Textbook and Learning Materials Policy and whatever in plan, 2007, at the same time as this curriculum comes out, there is a decision to deregulate the textbooks. All of us, like Ameena, and I think way back in 1992, this fight has been going on to deregulate the textbooks. Let the private sector produce the textbooks. But this action plan of 2007 made it so complex that no publisher worth their salt want to create an investment which will probably never be redeemed and never have the textbooks, although people like Ameena did go on and on and on. And we had some new textbooks produced which mercifully are being used by the Sindh Education Foundation, but that is a very small part of the population that does have access to those books. However, we had that, the national curriculum 2007, but this is 2012 today, and we have just inching of the implementation of this national curriculum. What we do have instead is that we have books that are coming out which are not, for example, following, in, because in this they have said what the chapters should look like. For example, there should be a one section which is on prose, one section, for, this is the Urdu curriculum, one should be on poetry, another section should be on language and so on and so forth. And they've even given you some headings as well, what kind of topics to pick. However, what comes out in these textbooks, and I will just take one leaf out of it, just from the contents. This is a Singh textbook board book for class 5, Urdu ki panchvi kitab, and it starts with Hamd. This is Urdu class 5. It says totally different things here, but the textbook writers mafia cannot get out of that mindset that was earlier described by the speakers that preceded me. So it starts with Hamd, maaf kar dene wali nabi, ummat ki afzal tareen khatoon, Hazrat Usman Ghaniullah, Naath, and so on. Now when you have this sort of, this is an Urdu book. So what is this? And it doesn't get finished there. We then have the 18th Amendment, mercifully, and we finally, the children of Pakistan, have the right to education 25A, which says all children between the ages of 5 to 16 will have compulsory education. Great. It's been almost 23 months. We still don't have any law on that. And everybody is foot dragging because they know where will the resources come from. The good story news was the right to education and the devolution of education to the provincial to the provinces. But the problem is that the provinces now are saying that we do not have the money to implement and we do not have the capacity to implement also. If we look at the provincial institutional regimes for creating curriculum and textbooks and challenging all of this, we have the Bureau of Curriculum, the textbook boards, the teacher training institutions, pre and in service. We have the National Education Assessment System and the Provincial Education Assessment Systems and the Boards of Intermediate and Secondary Education. And then we know that we have the many task forces that have been set up. So the textbooks are really stuck in an irrelevance regime and also in an emaciated citizenry, which is why I think Faisal's starting point is so very powerful. And in fact, in spite of all these innumerable exercises to create new textbooks, we have a massive disconnect between the national curriculum and what we have as textbooks. We have problems of factual language errors, content, irrelevance, misinterpretation, compounded by what Zubeda said very nicely, teachers who do not teach, and really far away from the DNA of our children, and Pervez would know that better. Nature had really had programmed our children to be highly liberated, as we see them, but we shackled them in schools, homes, and society. Our children demand and deserve better. I'd just like to say that we had a children's literature festival, 2011, 22,000 children came to that festival with Ameena there, and we had a segment there which was speakers' corners for children from 5 to 6, 18 years of age. Bol ke la bazaar hai tere. And in that, what the children had to say, I wish we were hearing that. And I'm going to read just very briefly from one of the girls who had put this down. She's from grade 10. My journey has been dull, filled with despair and shame, and the innumerable faces that I could blame. When I'm gone and amongst you no more, dismiss me with words, I was gone because I came. My contributions meant little to you, for never was I one to reach for the stars, but I please my haggard and tired conscience by believing that I did my part. And it goes on. It's an extremely sad narration, and there were so many narrations and as well as poetry in this festival that we heard. And but is anyone listening to these children? We also had a section on textbooks, opening or closing minds, and where the children complained and they said, and this is children not from the ONA level schools, these were the children from the government schools who said, you know, how those particularly social studies, Urdu, English and mathematics, they put them off entirely. They complained of excessive use of religion, ideology, direct or indirect bigotry, poor gender-based biased imagery, repetitive lessons across grades, and this is their words, and excessive use of war stories without enhancing their language competencies. Now, this is what endorses all our researchers are saying and what our speakers have said. So we have a real tragedy at hand. We have social studies books in grade 6, which talk, and we all get very happy when we say a social studies book in grade, for grade 6, which has something on South Asia, and which has something on children in South Asia. I immediately opened and said, what does this textbook say on children of South Asia? And it is exactly that. It's, you know, nothing about the real children of South Asia. It just stereotypes them. What does a child, and they never called, by the way, India, they always called Bharat, and say, what is a Bharati child believe in, what is a Bharati child wear, and what is a Bharati child eat? And by the way, when they come to sports, it's never about girls' sports. It's always about boys' sports, whether it's a boy in Maldives or in Pakistan or wherever. And so, I am saying, so can we dare to act? Can we all over here? Karachi Literature Festival should not be just taken as an act of celebrating literature and coming together. I think it should be seen as a platform of protest and a platform for action. I think today, because of the devolution and the 18th Amendment, before, by the way, the 20th Amendment takes it over and does something else to it, I think it may be worth our while to ponder that because there is a capacity gap and because there is a will gap, because also there may be a resource gap, the state is very happy to take any support from anyone. All of us who are here today, some of us are very serious people who do go, believe in taking action and go about doing our businesses. And I think the business today is writing alternate textbooks. And writing textbooks which make a difference, and we must act now. We have a window of opportunity. Why can't books that I think Fauzia had, and I think so many beautiful textbooks and other books that have come out today in this festival, like Amai and the Banyan Tree, contributions from the amazing 140-odd authors and poets. Why can't we find that space and interpretations in the textbooks, the alternate textbooks, presented to them? I don't even mind this format, which is not bad at all, because nobody reads it, because it's difficult to implement, to do it in such a way that we can find space and interpretations and connections to time, to our present, future and past, for relevance, pleasure, imagination, and well-rooted national and global citizenry. I think KLF presents a grand opportunity of authors under one umbrella. I think a group of authors from here can get together on a textbook writing project. I think what today we heard from the Baghairat Brigade, they need to create a populist platform for having satire on textbooks and having enough people, young people, be mobilized so they will also become writers of textbooks and we overcome the inertia of the system, the machinery of the public sector and also the citizens of this country. I end with that. It's an opportunity not to be missed.
Thank you, Baela. I want to add very quickly that the textbooks that have been discussed are really the textbook board textbooks. And I would like to, I'm sure all of you know that Oxford University Press publishes a large number of textbooks which can be benchmarked against any high-quality textbooks published anywhere in the world. The only problem is that the state sector is completely closed to us. We are not allowed to enter any government school or supply any government school with textbooks published by Oxford University Press. May I now open the... we have time for two quick questions. Well, Kamran Nurani? Panel, please.
Pervez, I would like to direct it to you. I'm a little confused. There are a lot of people over here who listen to you and appreciate what you said and clap, and they will sit in a gathering where Imran Khan is there, who is talking about how we should defeat America and we are great and we have got everything, and they'll clap for him also. What is this confusion in our mind? We don't know where we belong.
One question for that.
I guess it just shows how desperate we are, because the politicians have failed us, 65 years of not getting anywhere. Now here comes this guy who says that I'm going to fix it all in 90 days. So, well, you got to believe someone. Therefore, I think that's why a lot of people do that. Plus, he's not personally tainted in the sense that he hasn't stuffed his pockets. But there are other reasons to be worried, and I am very worried, because after all, it is the mindset that determines whether we are to progress or we are to regress. And I am especially worried because he is not willing to look within the problems of the society, but wants to blame others, America. My last interaction with him was a very unfortunate one on Geo television, in which, Hamid Mir asked him, what's happening in Swat? There was butchery every day in huge numbers. And Imran Khan said, well, obviously it's a reaction. If you have a superpower which invades a third world country, what do you expect? Will they take it lying down? And so Hamid Mir asked me, he says, do you agree, Professor? And I said, of course not. If the Taliban want to fight the Americans, go fight them in Afghanistan. How on earth can anyone tolerate this? To which Imran Khan said, I'm an American agent. So fine, so be it. I'm still waiting for my check to come, though.
Good afternoon. I'm Aisha Tariq, and I'm the author of Islam in Modern Perspective. It's a textbook for O-level Islamiyat, which has been approved by the University of Cambridge. I'm glad that Mr. Faisal addressed his concern about incorporating Islam in our education system. Well, I have two questions for this forum. First of all, don't you think that we should be utilizing the tools of ijma and ijtihad to solve all these recent problems in light of Islamic theory? And then maybe we can incorporate parts of it in our education system. Because I don't think that it's a good idea to deny students of the Islamic perspective altogether. After all, it's a postmodern world. Let them choose whatever is the best option. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the very instructive talks I've heard from all of you. My question is to anyone who can answer it. You see, the impression you have conveyed is that the textbooks are creating this kind of mindset, I mean, to a large extent. And then Baela tells us that in the Asal report, I think you say about 45% of the children can even read a sentence. So I was just wondering, what is the source of this kind of mindset? Because if the children are not reading those books, it means that they are not getting it from there. And from where are they getting it?
Yes, I'd like to answer this question. In fact, there were two questions. It is not a question of the textbook of Islam being used or not used. The question is, if a language textbook, which is compulsory, Pakistani Hindus read it, Pakistani Christians read it, if that textbook becomes ipso facto a book also on Islamic studies, then those people are subjected to a religion different from theirs, whether they want to or not. Now, if they want to study Islam, otherwise they're welcome. Everybody's welcome. You're welcome to study Christianity or Hinduism or Judaism or whatever. But that choice is taken away from them. That is why the separate place of teaching religion to Muslim children, etc., that was not contested, even in the subtle subversion report. People said otherwise, but that was not subverted. What was said was that whatever subject is being taught, not all subjects should therefore become Islamic studies, and that is what the first speaker was talking about. The other one, the influences which people have. You know, what happens is that a textbook is explained by someone, by the teacher. The textbook becomes something. The text is not what is written over there, but what the teacher makes it. The examples the teacher gives, the prejudices the teacher puts in, the closeness the teacher brings over there, the openness which the teacher takes away. Those things happen. Children carry away those impressions. It is very easy to carry away the impression of hating somebody because it's that easy, you know. You've heard it and you've seen movies on it, you've seen dramas on it, you've heard it otherwise, etc. Textbooks, therefore, compound those prejudices, those biases which already exist. That is the reason why one wants them to be changed. Thank you.
I'm afraid we've run out of time. I'd like to close this session. I'd like to thank Dr. Tariq Rahman, Dr. Pervez Hoodbhoy, Dr. Baela Raza Jamil, and Dr. Faisal Bari, and all of you for joining us. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.